So let's talk about possibilities. A lot of what we say has to do with the world as we know it. Words like board game and bicycle pick out real objects that we can see and touch. But language also lets us talk about stranger things, like monsters and portals and superpowers. Those are things that might not exist in our world, but we can still make sense of what they mean. So how can we capture our understanding, not only of the world the way it is, but how it could be, or how we wish it were? I'm Moti Lieberman, and this is the Ling Space.
Welcome to the Ling Space.
Up until now, we've mostly been talking about the meanings of words like they point to things somewhere out there in the world. Proper names like Nancy and Barb can refer to individual people, while descriptions like the state of Indiana or that can of Coke pick out specific places and things. Common nouns like waffle or radio, or adjectives like worried or spooky, are more abstract, since they apply to whole collections of things. But even then, we've managed not to stray too far from everyday experience. Meaning is a pretty complex idea, but semantics strives to find ways to talk about it and pin it down in the same way that phonetics does with sounds, or syntax with structures. We've already seen a lot of good semantics tools in previous episodes, too. For instance, we can already account for when simple sentences turn out to be true or false. Something like Barb is worried is true just as long as the person named Barb can be found inside the set of worriers. It's a pretty basic rule, but it's also a pretty good one because it works for any sentence that starts with some name or other and ends with a common noun or adjective. If you think about it, that's a lot of coverage. The reason this system works so well is because we're able to set out with just a couple small pieces and then connect them together as needed, assembling more and more complicated parts. We could start off by saying that specific people and places and things are all different kinds of entities, which we can represent with the letter E. So like Joyce or Hawkins Middle School, things we can point out in the world. Now, we can say things about those entities, make sentences about them, and those are going to be either true or false. We can shorten the truth value of sentences to T in our notation. E and T are like semantic categories. They help us keep track of the kinds of objects that words represent, entities, truth values. And with only these two types in our repertoire, we already have enough to build up the meanings of things like common nouns and adjectives. In a sentence like Barb is worried, the adjective worried combines with the Barb entity we know and love, and our brains work out the result to be true or false. So, since they tend to combine with words that represent entities of type E to produce sentences of type T, we can go ahead and call them type ET. Okay, great. So now we're starting to have a symbolic vocabulary to help us talk about how our minds deal with chunks of meaning. We have proper and common nouns and adjectives covered. So, let's look at verbs. Verbs are a little more diverse, since they can be intransitive, transitive, or ditransitive, but our type system works here too. So an intransitive verb like vanish combines with only one entity at a time, making a type ET. Will vanished connects just two things in the same way that Barb is worried does. A transitive verb like take combines with an object and then a subject, making a type EET. The brackets are nested like that because one entity always has a tighter relationship with the truth value than the other does, like in Jonathan took a picture. Finally, ditransitive verbs like give need an indirect object as well, making it E-E-E-T. Our system is versatile enough to handle just about everything that we can throw at it. Even more complex words like every and some, which combine with nouns, adjectives, and verb phrases, can fit in now. In the sentence, some students are missing, the words student and missing are each type E-T, since they represent whole sets of entities. That means some must be type E-T-E-T-T. It combines with two sets at a time and spits out true if they couple up in the right way. This whole framework, based mostly on real-world entities, centers around what nouns and adjectives and sentences refer to. We call the real-world things the bracketed structures point to their extensions. That focus might seem narrow, but it goes a long way towards understanding how language works. One way that type theory is super handy is that it helps us make predictions about how words are going to behave. In the sentence, an officer interviewed each suspect, you can see that there's two possible interpretations. One where a single officer interviewed everyone, and one where each suspect got interviewed by someone different. We can predict that according to our framework. The word each is the same type as some, while the word suspect is type ET. They combine according to their types to give us something of type ETT. But since the verb interview is type EET, we're at an impasse. The verb's looking for an entity of type E, while the noun phrase is looking for a simple intransitive verb of type ET, not a transitive one. They simply can't get along, and that's why we get both interpretations. You end up with the option of sticking that noun phrase either just below an officer or just above it, producing two opposing outcomes. The sentence can come out to mean either one, and our theory explains how the choices we make in resolving these kinds of conflicts lead to different results. These are impressive feats for just two little letters. But near the end of the 19th century, German philosopher Gottlob Frege recognized that it wasn't enough to talk about what words refer to. We can only go so far thinking about the act of reference. We have to start thinking about sense. To put it another way, we need to move closer to the word meaning as we normally understand it. Not just something out there in the world, but something more closely tied to the people using those words. To get some idea of why this matters, consider two different labels that point to the same thing. Say, domestic dog and canis lupus familiaris. In terms of what they refer to, they're identical, since they named exactly the same set. But there's an important difference, not only because one sounds more sciency than the other, but because it's possible for someone to know the meaning of one and be totally in the dark about the other. Not to mention that one of them's much more common. So, in some way, their meanings diverge. That might not seem like that big of a deal, but the problem runs much deeper. Let's say Mike's new friend L is trustworthy, and let's say Lucas's friend Dustin is too. But because Lucas doesn't really know Mike's new friend, he believes Dustin is trustworthy, but he doesn't think that about L. Now, how do we work out how each sentence came to be true or false? In an extensional system which deals in the real world, the word believe would be type T-E-T. It combines with a sentence of type T first, and then a subject of type E. There aren't any mismatches, but there's a much bigger problem lurking. We don't have any way of pairing up subjects with the sentences that they actually believe. Like, we said, Lucas believes Dustin is trustworthy is true, while Lucas believes L is trustworthy is false. Yet, the verb believes has no way of seeing inside the sentence underneath it. At best, it can see its truth value, which in L's case is actually true. Whether the whole thing comes out true or false really depends on the content of the sentence itself, not just its truth value. And so the truth value of the whole thing varies independently of the truth values of its parts. So it isn't enough for a word like believe to know whether the sentence it connects to is true or false. It needs some way of getting at its inner workings. In other words, it needs to move past the sentence's truth value, which is its extension, and peek into the sentence's true meaning, its intention. So what does that look like? On the one hand, this seems to be more of a question for psychologists. Like, it seems we're trying to get at what's inside people's heads and tap into their thoughts about the world. But as linguists, we can still move closer than we are now. Close enough, in fact, to solve our problem. In the middle of the 20th century, while exploring new kinds of logic, philosophers like Rudolf Carnap and Saul Kripke introduced the key idea of possible worlds. A possible world is just one of many ways the world could have been. So, one possible world would be exactly like ours, but where everyone still dresses like it's the 1980s. And another possible world would be one where everything's the same, only upside down. In principle, there's an infinite number, some with big changes that make the universe uninhabitable, and others with such tiny tweaks that you would never even notice. What's useful for us is that for any given sentence, it's going to be true in some worlds and false in others. And when we understand that different people might disagree about exactly which world we live in, we start to see how we might take advantage. Let's see how this works. So we can't just say that sentences themselves are possible worlds, since possible worlds are big, complicated things, and that wouldn't make much sense. Sentences are still the sorts of things that can turn out to be true or false. What we can do is modify the meaning of each sentence so that its truth value depends on the specific world it's applied to. And if you remember back to our episode about the language of lambda calculus, it's pretty much as easy as slapping a lambda on the front. What that means is that we've created a function that goes looking for a world W such that L is trustworthy in it. But instead of doing something with numbers, it takes a world and churns out a truth value according to that world. In Mike and Lucas's world, the function comes out true, but in worlds where L is unreliable, it doesn't. And this is the intention of a sentence. A way of sorting through worlds and collecting together all the ones that share that sentence in common, where it's actually true. And while this change might look more cosmetic than constructive, it lets words like believe and also know and hope and promise see into the sentence by letting them look at the kinds of worlds it describes. So at last, the meaning of a word like believe written out in lambda calculus looks like this. So believe is a function which takes in the intention of a sentence, so the worlds it describes, and then it combines with the subject and checks to see if all the worlds consistent with the subject's thoughts about their own world form part of the worlds described by the sentence. Basically, it makes sure that the believer's beliefs are compatible with the sentence that follows. In someone like Lucas's case, it checks to see if the worlds where L is trustworthy capture the way Lucas thinks about his world. It skips past whether the sentence is true or false, since in this case, it doesn't matter, and it goes straight for what's in people's heads. With the sharpened tool of possible world semantics in our hands, we can manage to cut through the barrier to better understanding how words really work and what they mean. So we've reached the end of the Ling space for this week. If you made it back to the real world, you learned that we can discover a lot about how language works just by looking at entities and truth values and how they combine. That such a simple theory of meaning can't quite explain how words like believe and hope work, since it can't get inside speakers' heads. And that by introducing possible worlds, we gain a new and deeper way of talking about language. The Ling space is made by all these amazing people over here. If you want to learn more about where intentions come from, check back on our website, and while you're there, why not check out our store? We're also on Tumblr, Twitter, and Facebook, and if you want to keep expanding your own personal Ling space, please subscribe, and we'll see you next time. Nagamisenii!